stupidly. You can be whatever you want to be. Even someone good. By the way, I should have an equal amount of security. This is insulting.
You just can't help yourself.
I'm joined today by the amazing award-winning producer, Natalie Holt.
Hi.
You may know her from Three Girls, The Honorable Woman, Journey's End, Paddington, and a little show called Loki. Yeah. Natalie, it's great to have you here, especially since the finale aired like a couple days ago, and I'm sure you know that the reception has been insane. How have you been receiving it, and how's that been so far?
Oh my gosh, yeah, it's been kind of overwhelming and really flattering to see, you know, people doing like tribute versions of the themes and enjoying the music so much. It's really funny when you're working in a team, you just feel like you're the only people, you're making it for you and your team, and I can't really think about like the people watching it. So yeah, I do have to just kind of like go into my own space and like just tap into that creativity and just create the thing that I think is going to work and the thing that I like, and then hope that everybody else likes it too. So it just came through like a blanket call out. So I just put together like a kind of mixtape, sent it off. And then I guess Kate Heron and Kevin Wright, who was the creative executive producer who was on over the show, and I met him in the meetings. I think it was down to a few, like a small number of composers, and then we all had to score a scene, which was in episode one where they come down the elevator and Loki's taken into the time theater. I went to town on it, and it got like loads of live instruments on it, and my friend Charlie Draper playing the theremin, and yeah, I just wanted to like blow Kate's mind and just do something that was really weird and cool, because you know that's kind of what she said she wanted. I was just super excited to get that job, because it did feel a bit like out of my league to do it with such a nice team as well, because you kind of think Marvel might be an intimidating organization to work for, like, because they're quite, you know, secretive and everything, but they were super nice and so supportive of everybody, and you know they just wanted people to kind of do their best work and to support them, like constant support and encouragement, and amazing. Yeah, it's cool.
That's great. I guess one of the biggest things as well coming into the series was that this was a brand new place that you had to score for, and this was a brand new, completely different, weird setting altogether with like the TVA. There are inspirations everywhere, but was it sort of like, okay, we'll go into this blank and we'll see what happens?
I didn't listen to, like, I loved Thor Ragnarok. I think that was one of my favorite Marvel movies. And Guardians as well. Like, I love those kind of more epic space areas of it, I guess. I didn't want to be too influenced, so I deliberately didn't like dig into it too hard and like reference it too much or listen to it too much. I was like, I just have to do my own take on it. And I think like I definitely did that in the pitch and they seemed to like it, so I'll just carry on doing that. Kate was sending me the dailies from Jonathan Majors' performance when they were shooting that, because she was like, I think you need to see this. I think like the way he's performing this character's kind of like blowing my mind. I want you to see it and be inspired by it. So I got those rushes through, and then that's when I was kind of writing the suite. So I wrote his theme, like his Kang theme, like first off the bat, like, and that was like, so I had the Loki theme and the Kang theme, because I knew that those were the two, you know, the kind of pivot points of the show. But then what seemed really interesting, I was like, oh, what, this Kang theme's like, I think it should be the TVA theme as well. He's in charge, he's behind everything, like he is the TVA. So that whole time, like when you're seeing, you know, it says it's called the TVA theme in the first volume of the album, and it is the TVA theme, but it is also, it's ultimately his theme.
You wrote it for Kang initially.
Yeah.
That's insane. Wow, that's
so
crazy.
So it's seeded
right
the whole way along. And then when you see his statue at the end, And you see that statue, and then you hear that's his theme, actually. It's not the TVA theme at all, it's his.
Take us through some of like the key instruments and musicians that were featured. I think you mentioned the theremin initially.
Kate was just like really clear. She was like, I really love the theremin. And that was like there right from the very first moment I met her. She had this piece by Clara Rockmore, the 1950s theremin player. She's amazing. And she does this version of the Swan, which we licensed and used in Renslayer's office. But that was in Kate's director package that she pitched to get the job. Weirdly, before I came on board like to do the pitch for Loki, I'd just done this musical kind of pass the parcel lockdown project with this ad agency that I worked for sometimes. This theremin player called Charlie Draper worked for as well. And so I'd just like bounce this music off this amazing theremin player, and he's a really cool guy. He collects like theremins and Anders Martinot as well. And he's got like a 1929 RCA, like an original instrument. Wow. Those are like the B movie sort of sci-fi instrument. Like we've got that original one in the Loki score. And I used it all over the place because the low end of it has, it's, you don't necessarily hear it as a theremin, but if you mix it and blend it in with like low brass, it just like adds this extra layer of power to it. Yeah, the theremin was just magic. I love, and Charlie was so happy to just like send me loads of different versions of things on different instruments that he owned. And like the love theme, we kind of used the Anders because it was a bit more mellow, but it still has that kind of theremin vibe. That was so cool. And I used the drums, like lots of live drums on all the action sequences. And like I've been posting a few clips on Twitter and Instagram of like the different musicians that I worked with, kind of showing behind the scenes of like their instrument and like different themes. So the Mobius theme.
I'm Agent Mobius, by the way.
I was really inspired by his like love of the jet ski, and I was imagining like, oh, I wonder what he listens to in his downtime. I reckon it would be like Bon Jovi. So then that Mobius theme was kind of like power chords and this guitar theme. And then there's the folk instruments, the kind of Nordic earthy folk instruments. Like that, I used a hardanger fiddle and a nickel harper with Eric and Olav, who were in this group called the Lodestar Trio that I'd heard of a few years before. And I just loved their sound. And it felt right to use those kind of earthy folk Norse instruments to kind of dig into Loki's past and his relationship with the women in his life. Yeah, I've been blasted on Twitter for, I don't know. I kind of said like that his mother and Sylvie are connected, but and so people are like, oh, incest, blah, blah, blah. But
I mean, the show has a bit of like iffy themes in it with Loki loving himself as well, so let's just all calm down with that.
But it is a really complicated relationship. Like they're clearly not brother and sister. Like they're not. Definitely. They're variants of the same person. So yeah, I did want to connect Sylvie and his mother musically, but not, I didn't want to imply anything dodgy.
Yeah, no, definitely not. Was there any one scene or any one piece that specifically stuck out to you, or was there one that you particularly favored?
I think I just really, really enjoyed scoring episode 6. Like just turning everything on its head and taking the themes, but then like breaking them up and like making them sound kind of fragmented and terrifying. And because I think I was so deep into that character and into the world by that point, so episode 6 just like flew out, and yeah, it was cool. And recording it with the orchestra, and yeah, it just flowed really nicely. Kang or He Who Remains is my sort of a soft spot for that character. I want to keep scoring for him.
As well, I think one of the things that people are most curious about is how a day in the life of a low-key composer looks like.
Marvel have a different way of doing things to the way I'd worked before, where I kind of landed the job and then came up with a suite of themes for the characters. So then when I came to score the episodes, it was like, Oh, yeah, that would be, I guess that's that character, that's this, and everything felt like it could be really thought through and thematic, because I've done that groundwork of like a month of putting that kind of suite together. The suite doesn't sound dissimilar, like I'd use all those weird processing things and run it through the analog tape machine, and I'd recorded all the live instruments onto that suite, so everyone kind of knew how it was going to sound, and everyone was on board with the direction I wanted to take it on. We had weekly music catch-ups, so I was like playing everyone where I was at that week, and this is what I've done, and you know, it was like I've never had to be that open, but it was quite cool to have them come in when I was like, well, I'm halfway through this, but I'll play it to you anyway. And Kate's like a really strongly led by the music, and she's really great at kind of directing the music as well. So yeah, I loved working with her.
I think, and lastly, I think before we let you go, I know everyone must be asking you this, so I won't ask it. I promise I won't ask it. I'm not gonna do that to you. I'm not gonna spare you the agony of having to like hide the secrets. But what can we expect in the near future? What other projects should we keep an eye out for? What's in store for you personally? And which Marvel movies are you working on? Okay, go. No, I'm just kidding. But like, please tell us. Please
working
tell us.
Working on what... any Marvel movies. I wish I was. I've got a movie coming out in the autumn on Netflix called Fever Dream, a kind of really beautiful kind of journey through Argentina, and it's like a mother and daughter relationship, and they're like dealing with a very strange illness, and so it feels very timely, and it's sort of about global warming, like the earth and what we're doing to it and how we're messing it up. I loved working with Claudia Losa, the director, so that's coming out. You can listen to that.
That's great. That's fantastic. That sounds
you know, great. Marvel news. Who knows? Fingers crossed. I'd love to work on a Marvel project, because then I think they're great.
That was perfect. Thank you so much for your time, Natalie. You've knocked it out of the park with Loki. We can't wait for season two. Fingers crossed you'll be on that. Thank you so much, Natalie. Hope you have a good day.
Thank you.
Stay
lovely
safe.
To meet you. Okay.
You too. Thank you.
Bye.